Hello everyone, welcome to this evening's free community webinar, Leading with Vision, Our Pathway Through 2024 and Beyond. My name is Tracy Duncan, and on behalf of the team at Fearless, thank you so much for joining us. While everyone is logging in and getting settled, and before I hand over to our hosts, just some general housekeeping and announcements. As always in our webinars, we welcome any questions you have. Please comment in the Q&A section, and we hope to have some time at the end of the session to answer these. We will also be recording this webinar, and a link will be sent to all registered attendees in the coming days. So if you're unable to attend this event live or need to duck off early, you're still able to view the recording at your own convenience. Fearless is a charity run by volunteers. We are always grateful to receive donations, no matter how small, to continue the work we do. Our vision is to restore control to people living with post-traumatic stress. Donations can be made via our website, www.fearless.org.au. Please stay connected with Fearless socially on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and LinkedIn. We provide updates on any upcoming webinars and events on these pages, so be sure to follow us. And finally, the content in today's webinar is not intended to be a substitute for professional medical advice or treatment. You should seek the advice of an appropriately qualified healthcare professional before making decisions about your own circumstances. You should not disregard professional medical advice or delay seeking it because of any information contained in today's webinar. Okay, let's get started. Good afternoon, Chris. I will now hand over to you.
Thanks very much, Tracy, and a happy new year to all our participants, and you included, Tracy. Before I begin, I want to acknowledge the traditional owners of the lands on which we meet and pay our respects to their elders past, present and emerging, and give them our respect for the stewardship of our country that they've exercised over the last 60,000 years or so. And I do that behalf of the Fearless family. You will know that Fearless has been around since 2014, so we've virtually celebrated our 10th year anniversary, and that has caused us to stop, think, consider, and try to work out where we need to go next. And that is really the theme of this particular webinar opening up for this year. We have developed new directions for post-traumatic stress disorder Australia, New Zealand, and I hope that will become clear over the next couple of years. But it's one of the reasons that gives me very great pleasure to introduce to all of you tonight, Paul Milne. Paul is a former policeman. Paul has got a fascinating story to tell, and Paul has just joined the board of PTSD Australia, New Zealand and Fearless, and will be taking over as the chief executive from Alex Gerrick over the next 4 weeks or so. And I know Paul has got a head full of good ideas where he thinks the organisation ought to go, and I've invited him to share those ideas with us online tonight. So can I encourage you, if you have a view of anything that you hear tonight, please put it into the Q&A and let us know what you think. Because after all, this organisation doesn't exist to satisfy me or Paul or Tracy. It is actually to satisfy you, the people out there who are looking to exercise control of dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder in their lives, whether they're sufferers or family members or friends and colleagues. I also have to say that in the 10 years that I've been associated with this organisation, I had always thought that I would be able to look back one day and say, you know what, we've really done well. We've reduced the number of people in our community that are having to deal with post-traumatic stress disorder. I regret to say to you tonight, I think actually the opposite is true. And when I look throughout the Australian community of today, and I think about all the usual causes of PTSD, and by that I mean the occasional natural disaster, I do mean domestic violence, family violence, I do mean victims of violent crime. I do mean people who have lost a lot of money when they shouldn't ought to have done. And I do mean people who have faced traumatic events on the roads and in their workplaces. When I look back over the last 10 years and I think about the floods and the fires and on, I think the numbers have gone up. And I think the case for dealing with post-traumatic stress disorder is more urgent now than at any time I can remember. And that's why I'm quite excited about the re-energizing of the organization that's going to happen under new leadership, new directions, and trying to make a much more improved difference inside the Australian community. And so it's my very great pleasure to introduce to you Paul Mill. I ran into Paul not that long ago, tell you the truth. But I was very impressed by the work he has done. I was very impressed by his approach to dealing with the issues that we're going to talk about. And I'm very excited that he's now volunteered to come on board as our new chief executive and provide real helmsmanship for the organisation. So, Paul, can I ask you now to tell the Fearless family a little bit about your own experience in dealing with trauma and what it meant to you subsequently and your involvement in organisations that look a bit like Fearless.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you for that delightful introduction. Obviously, it's quite embarrassing sometimes when people introduce me, but I've come from a background of the policing in the Northern Territory. I started back in 2004. And subsequently through my career, I got to the role of sergeant, and I was obviously looking after many troops throughout the, those years. And obviously I saw a lot of things in my time, a lot of things I obviously tried to forget, and obviously numbed them out through the years. And back in 2013, I was diagnosed with PTSD, major depression, anxiety. Looking back at those times, I didn't know what PTSD was compared to what I know now. And looking at putting things in place, like being more self-aware of yourself, your own body, I wasn't aware of it at that time. And now obviously doing a bit more resilience in what I've achieved, working for other organisations in this sector, highlights the role of getting more support to people in all areas of the community, not just first responders, but every other sector that we deal with in Australia, because obviously people deal with trauma in different ways. And I've learned through my time in treatments that not one treatment will solve your problems. It's a combination of different things, which I've learned through the last few years, that not just medication, but looking at a more holistic approach to how we treat things is more beneficial, I believe, for myself. And obviously, it may work for other people, it may not work for other people. But I think if you have the mindset to try, and there is a possibility that you will achieve something that you haven't imagined before. And where I sit today, and looking back where I was 12 years ago, I couldn't have imagined where I sit right now. Working with organisations like Fearless, Beyond Blue, Phoenix Australia, the Black Dog Institute, Lived Experience Australia, they're all got such an amazing point to them that they have empathy towards the people that they're trying to help. And I find that now within the leadership of even different organisations, that just having a little bit of empathy towards people will obviously keep you in a good mindset, that your people will actually feel supported and trusted by every organisation they work for. So the treatment I went through, originally I went through, I had ECT, I've done EMDR, I've done TMS, and I did a program through Phoenix Australia, which was, I think, very beneficial to me. It was a program that you... relearning about your feelings, and obviously being having PTSD, you become numb and you lose all sense of your feelings, how to love, how to laugh. And so now, like after doing that course, I became aware of my body's reactions to certain feelings now. And as I said, it's just a combination of different things that have sort of helped me throughout the years that I can now feel love. I can feel happiness, and obviously I can still feel sad. And obviously when a good movie's on, I might tend to have a bit of a cry, but I didn't used to do that for many years. But it's something, it's just a different feeling now that when you actually feel something, you can feel it in your body, and it's totally different. Sometimes it's hard to explain, but I used to be on medication, and I eventually got off medication a few years ago, and it's totally different because medication didn't work for me because I had a high metabolism. So I went through many months of going to Ward 17 in Heidelberg, Victoria, to change my medication because after 6 weeks, I got to a point where the medication stopped working and I was either going higher or lower. But obviously with medication, there can be some side effects. And the benefits of having the side effects through the medication, I decided to change the way I looked at how I did things. So I got myself involved in yoga, Pilates. I actually spoke to a few monks about, you know, different things. I did a lot of mindfulness, which is fantastic. Muscle relaxation. I looked into chakras. It's like there's a whole world out there to help people with PTSD. And sometimes the biggest problem I found initially was information and knowledge. If there's some way that we can pass on the information to people, and like even if it's just one spot that they can go to eliminate the stress of searching through, you know, computers and internets trying to find the right information, it might be a lot easier to go to one spot and find that information and actually help people.
Well, that's a really interesting set of observations, Paul, and very introspective in looking at your own situation. I'm kind of reminded as a very early story that I heard when thinking about setting up PTSD ANZ. And, you know, effectively that came out of my concerns about the continued deployments of people into Afghanistan. But I was off having my eyes tested one night, and the ophthalmologist said to me, "Oh, so what are you doing now?" And I explained that I was thinking of setting up this thing to deal with post-traumatic stress disorder in the Australian community. And she said, "Well, I have PTSD." And I looked at her and I thought, "You've got to be kidding me. You've got PTSD?" I thought. I said, "Tell me your story." And you know what? She had a story that's not very dissimilar to the one you've just said. But she made one very important observation, which resonated with me. She said, "You know, I'm lucky. I'm lucky because I own the business. If I don't go to work on Monday, no one's going to miss me. I can take days off when I feel the red haze coming down and I know I'm about to lose control, and I can go and look after myself. But I feel very sorry for those people who have actually got a commitment they've got to meet, work colleagues that they might let down." And I thought, you know what? That makes a lot of sense. And I kind of understand now the flow-on effects of PTSD in people's lives and how it has an impact, not just with yourself, but also those people around you. Yeah. And then I started to think about families, and I started to think about, you know, how do children think about their parents who might be suffering from PTSD and have these horrible events occur to them? And that was one of the very strong reasons why we said, you know, exercising control of your situation is actually, if you like, the mantra for being for PTSD, ANZ and Fearless. And we've talked about the management toolbox, and it reflects exactly what you said. There's a whole range of things out there you can do to look after yourself. And a lot of them without taking pills.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you talk to toxicologists, many of them will tell you the pills don't actually help you that much.
Yeah.
And actually going off and finding other things to try and help the situations where you need to go. So that's really interesting, Paul. But But what is it about Fearless that strongly attracted you to us, given all your other involvements?
I think it's just having the same sort of mindset when we think about supporting people, obviously with PTSD. And as you just mentioned about families, I've got a big thing for families. I was lucky I had a family initially when I was going through that. And obviously, if someone doesn't have a family, this, where do they look to? And just getting support for families. Like I heavily believe in clinical peer support for families because they're the ones that are, they're on the cold front. They're actually helping someone who has PTSD. And sometimes you don't know what's going on or what to do or how to help. And just having that support measure in place would benefit a lot of families in Australia on how to assist their other family members dealing with PTSD.
Mm.
And when I got to a certain point in my recovery and I started speaking out a bit more about, you know, being an advocate for mental health and PTSD, and then I came across Fearless and obviously had a look at the website and what you guys were interested in and what you wanted to do with how we look after people, the clinical research, it's so important. And I got involved with the Heart to Heart Foundation, the walk was last year for premature mortality. And I contacted Fearless, got to know Belinda Neal very well, and the ball started rolling from there. And just building those connections on how we can all be a bit more collaborative on how we look after people is very important to me. And I believe that Fearless, being a national organisation, has that potential to be a peak body in that area to assist in getting that information out to people and providing another avenue to look at to help themselves. And I feel like self-determination is very important. If we can make people or help people find a way themselves to help themselves, I think it's important that they can feel a bit more self-achievement that I've done it myself. And that's how I look at myself, that what I've achieved now is, it's through hard work, I admit that, but there is a process you've got to get to. And I think if you can be an example for someone to say, look, I'm in the dark spot, I don't know what I'm doing, but you know, if you speak to people and say, well, this is what I've tried, it might not try for you, but you can do it. There is, you can turn things around. You can reinvent yourself. And I think that's very important for people, that once you lose that identity, you go searching for it. And if you can't find the identity, your expectations are not met. You don't know what your purpose in life is anymore. So just finding your purpose, I think, is very important to, you can achieve anything you want. Just take your time, breathe about it. Don't sweat the big or small things. I think it's time now I look at how you position yourself with stress. And I think stress was a major part for me when I went through, obviously, my PTSD, because it's not just the trauma you see, it's life trauma. It's the stresses of life, you know, paying your mortgage, dealing with your kids, going out, did I get the promotion? I didn't get the promotion. So I think it's very important that we just be able to break things down a little bit easier. And through guidance, I think people can achieve a lot more in their lives.
Yeah, and in all of that experience, the role of networking, I mean, talking to people with a story of their own, not the same as yours, but nonetheless, shared stories can play an important role, surely.
Definitely. I think you can understand like where people come from. And like, for instance, when I was in Ward 17, there was all veterans, there was emergency response veterans, and you could just sit in a room and not say anything, but you understood what was going on in people's minds. You could tell. So having that ability to understand where you sit in life and how we work together, I think it's very important. And just passing on the information of what you've learned through recovery can be a benefit to a lot of people, because sometimes they might not have thought of that aspect of recovery. As I said, I found it very important that we can all achieve something if we put our minds to it.
Yeah, I'm just reflecting on a webinar that we had last year with Steve Robson, who's the president of the Australian Medical Association. And Steve told his story of trauma, but also potential suicide. It was a very compelling story. And I think surprised many people that someone of his stature now in the community would fess up and say, this is where I've come from, and encouraging people to step out and get things done to help themselves. All right, well, I think that's terrific. Now, I wonder if you'd care to outline for all of us now as the Fearless Family, your ideas for where you want to take the organisation over the next year or so.
Sure, I can do that. Not a problem. Well, first off, Fearless have got amazing things going at the moment, especially the national conversation was in 2021. I have a couple of ideas. I just think that even with the national conversation, I like to see it virtual and in person. And the reason I like it in person, because sometimes obviously people deal with interaction differently to be on a computer to actually being in person. And having a national conversation while in person, and obviously having, you know, your latest research virtually, you can get researchers from overseas. Like, we have amazing researchers in Australia, academics. But I think just spreading that web a little bit further to find out exactly what's going on in the rest of the world and passing that information on, I think it would be such a benefit to people, obviously for the national conversation in Australia, and also just having people who have reinvented themselves to come in person to the national conversation. People who have suffered PTSD, they've gone through recovery, and they've reinvented themselves and, you know, created new businesses to help different sectors. I think that's important to show people that you have the ability to change your whole life around, even though you had PTSD, but just showing people that you can actually do something worthwhile in your life and you find yourself again. And just showing people that there's so many organisations out there in Australia at the moment dealing with PTSD, the groups as well, and just creating a national database on how we can all work collaboratively together and have a better understanding of who's actually doing what in Australia and who's duplicating themselves, and just finding out what we can do together to achieve things a bit more proactive in this space. Also, I believe that the current landscape is ineffective at the moment with PTSD. As I said, like, some organisations are popping up all the time and, you know, helping in this space, which is fantastic. But I just think there should be a bit more clinical backing behind some of them at this stage. As you said before, like, you know, you've got the invent of psychedelics coming into it now, which is fantastic. Like, it's a new aspect on how we can possibly deal with PTSD. And I think there's so many avenues now that just going to one spot, I believe that, like, having a national database on all these organisations where we can just one click and find them all and go, okay, I'm in Newcastle. This is what I've got at the moment. Do have someone that can actually speak for first responders with PTSD, like a psychiatrist, and having that cultural competency of dealing with people. And so people have that rapport straight away. And I think that's the biggest thing when you're actually speaking to a practitioner, is having that rapport. Because once you build up your trust, then you can open up. And I think that's very important.
Yeah, I think it's exciting. I mean, one of the concerns we had in the early days of setting up the organisation were, you know, over 3,000 groups all around Australia thinking they were solving the problem of post-traumatic stress disorder in the community. A lot of them were associated with vets and first responders and whatever. Some of it was, and I'd be brutally honest, lacked evidence-based solutions. And I heard a few stories about here's the instant cure for the problem. But the experts kept telling me that, you know, it's not possible to change what's happened to people as a result of trauma by some simple approach like that. And that's another reason why we went down the base pathway of talking about evidence-based solutions, making sure that we were connected to the expertise of, say, Phoenix or the Thompson Institute up in Sunshine Coast, and so on and so forth. And painting a picture of hope for the future, which in my view has been strengthened by the possibility of the psychedelics coming into the frame, because the former director of the Thompson Institute once said to me that it's only through the use of psychedelics that we might actually be able to cure post-traumatic stress disorder. But there's a lot of research that's going to be needed before we can get down that down to the end of that promise. But however, his view was we have to try, and we have to try hard, because we won't get there if we don't. So, you know, the framing is very interesting around that. And coming back to national conversations, that bringing people to talk to each other in a place of a place that's safe to talk and open up and share stories and really be a bit introspective about your own problems, I think can do a lot of good for people who are struggling with their issues out there.
Yeah, definitely.
So in that connection, how do you think we might go about migrating ourselves into a national organisation that has got an extensive reach?
Well, as you said, with the national conversation, is it's a jewel in the crown for Fearless, and I believe that just a little bit more tweaking, I think it'd be really fantastic. Involving ourselves in a bit more with policy development in roles within government, I think would be helpful. Just so that we have a better mindset of actually how the government is currently thinking on how they can support people with PTSD, and just assisting with even the major problems at the moment, which I found is waiting times and people getting access to PTSD support and recovery options. The waiting periods at the moment are totally different now to what they were 10 years ago. For instance, you could be waiting 2 days to get into a ward to get some psychiatric help, but now it's up to 6 to 8 weeks. And I find if we can work together in a collaborative way with the community and consultation and lobbying and advocacy, it might assist in those areas for people to get better access to help quicker, and it will change their lives, basically. Yeah. Just getting that time in early.
I think being able to reduce the queues for getting qualified assistance is very important. I heard recently the waiting time for someone who might need a bed in a proper institute could be up to a couple of years. Well, that just sounds to me as ridiculously long and almost unhelpful, because it creates a trauma of its own. And I think we're seeing now in process of the Royal Commission into Defence and Veteran Suicide that processing within the bureaucracy can contribute to trauma as well. So somehow or another, we've got to deal with the red tape. We've got to smooth the pathways for people to get the proper help they need. And I also think myself that we've got to take the emphasis off handing out drugs for people just to dumb them down, rather than giving them some very real help so they can be in control of themselves, is an important thing to promote. So I think we've got a lot of work to do, Paul.
Yes, I think we have got a lot of work to do, especially in the regional areas. There should be a big push out to the regional areas, because they don't get as much resources as obviously the main cities. And there's a lot of people out in regional areas who are awfully struggling with different sorts of PTSD trauma, and just getting them better access to clinical support, as I said before, with peer support for families, is very important, because obviously they're doing it tough out there. And if Fearless can help in any way to alleviate that, I think we would have achieved something. And I've always said that if you can change one person's life, you've done your job. So, and being a national organisation, if we can change many lives, I think we've done our job too.
Yeah, I think one of the issues that we took up in the new direction planning last year was the idea of migrating regional hubs. We built a lot of the past 10 years in association with the creation of the Thompson Institute and the Sunshine Coast. That was an outcome of very poor suicide rates in the Sunshine Coast in 2010. It began work at the end of 2018 and did some fantastic work since then as a startup. People who have been on these webinars might recall we had Megan Dutton on last year talking about the current state of play with the building of the National PTSD Centre as an adjunct to the Thompson Institute. And that's going to open later this year, hopefully not too late away. And secondly, doing some ab initio research into mental health conditions in children and the consequences for adult mental health situations. And also putting in place a local product in the Sunshine Coast, a special app where people who had ideas of suicide could get instant help face-to-face rather than on the telephone. And that made a huge reduction in suicide ideation in the Sunshine Coast. And I guess the board sort of scratched its head and said, well, why can't we have four or five Thompson Institutes dotted around the country? Why don't we start? Well, eschewing the idea, as we always had, that we wouldn't go near a government for money because they can't be trusted. And, you know, stepping out now into the brave new world and saying, if we're going to achieve that outcome, we need help. And frankly, we do need the government's help to make that happen, both at state and federal government level. Do you think we should place a priority on that kind of transition process over the next 2 to 3 years?
Yes, I think it'd be a fantastic transition to do that. I think also just highlighting the need for those areas to have the correct resources is very important. And obviously in our role to highlight those needs towards obviously the government and getting more funding to those areas is going to be beneficial to a lot of people. And just building that trust with people that they know that they're going to get some sort of help, some sort of respite, and that word hope is very important for those people.
Yeah, I think that's critical, Paul. All right then. So that really sort of talks about the next couple of years, and I suppose what I'm going to do now is invite the audience to participate in this webinar. So I want to get some sort of feedback from the participants on what they think about our thoughts of the future and the priorities about where we want to go. How much emphasis should we place on another national conversation where we would like that to be? And thirdly, about approaching governments much more openly and seeking their help. So there's three key questions. I'm hoping the audience will be ready to respond to those. Any other observations you'd like to make, Paul, in going forward before we switch over to Q&A?
There's a lot of potential out there to achieve many great things. And having the right mindset in an organisation like Fearless and how I believe what we can do is exciting. And when people obviously think of Fearless, you think of, I can do anything. And if we can instill that in people and just having that little bit of self-determination and find a little bit of strength in themselves and the potential they can actually do it themselves, I think is very important for us. And if we go in the right direction, which I believe we will, it'll be fantastic.
Yeah, okay. I guess one of the things we ought to think about is how can community members help Fearless out there? You know, at the moment we sort of self-generate our ideas, but throw it out to the people on this webinar. How can the community help us, do you think?
Well, there's definitely a focus on funding would be very beneficial to not only the Fearless organisation, but to other organisations in this space. So if there was a way that we could alleviate the process of getting the funding out to the right organisations to achieve their goals, I think that's very important as well. And I think with collaboration through the community, we could achieve that.
Yeah, okay. Now, looking ahead, what would you say about the possibility of bringing more of the 3,500 odd organizations together? I guess we sort of felt that maybe we could be a national lobby organization, but not be out there trying to eat other organizations' lunches. I mean, we didn't want to steal anybody else's thunder. But on the other hand, you know, who speaks with a strong voice? We are focused on post-traumatic stress disorder. We're not across the mental health spectrum. And I think there are organizations. We are a member organization of Mental Health Australia, for example. We've worked with Phoenix and so on and so forth. We work with the Thompson Institute. We've connections with folks like Evan Jones at the Morrowfield Health Hub and all that sort of things. But, you know, looking to the wider audience and gathering some strength for our arm, how can we do better at trying to speak for the entire community?
I believe, like, even creating a membership of these organisations that are all coming together to try assist in recovery of PTSD, and just building that database of membership with Fearless and being able to talk on one voice to the government and say, this is what we need, this is what we require, these are the organisations that are doing amazing things in this country to help people, and just building that collaborative approach and having a cultural competency with these members and in their roles in different sectors of Australia, who they're looking after, because some potentially can be better at dealing with PTSD to another organisation. And just finding that fit for people, it would be very important for them to know that, okay, I heard about this organisation, they're really good, this is what I'm going through at the moment, this is my PTSD, which is going to vary to someone else. Everyone's PTSD is totally different to everyone else, so it's never the one thing. As I said, everyone's built differently. We react differently. We're more resilient than some others. And just having that knowledge of who to go to, I think, is very important, which will alleviate a lot of stress. And if we can minimize the stress, it's going to be beneficial to people to progress in their recovery very fast.
Yeah, sure. And I guess one of the difficulties, I guess, has always been that other organisations have different priorities and different views. They don't always accept what we want to say. And I go back to the early days when people were out there promoting their cures for PTSD. So that does become difficult. And you know, one of the issues that I think we've tried to deal with in the past is, you know, how do we provide better support for families? I mean, you know, I go back to the kids living with a parent with PTSD or partners having to deal with PTSD. You know, how do we better support them in moving forward? Do we include them in the membership? Do we have a separate activity for them as part of the organisation?
I think there should be a branch off for families. Obviously, the person dealing with PTSD is at the pinnacle point. They're the one who has the PTSD. But families, in turn, sometimes they probably suffer from PTSD as well. And just looking back at my time, it was traumatic for them, obviously seeing a parent go through what I was going through and not being able to support them. You know, your kids are seeing these things and it's like, well, who do I call? Who do I speak to now about helping these my children? And if we can find something and put something in place that families know they can go to a specific area and know that they'll get help with even just speaking with someone, and as I said before about clinical peer support for family members, just giving that extra little bit of knowledge so they can be guided on what to expect. This is normal. This is what's happening right now, and it'll pass. Like, there is a progression on how we recover. Like, everyone deals with recovery differently. Some will recover quicker than others, and some are prolonged. So it's passing on that information. And that was the biggest thing that I always went through, that I didn't have enough knowledge. I didn't know what was going on. I didn't know about PTSD. And through the years of learning and going through recovery and getting more knowledge, being able to pass that on is important to people to understand that they're, as I said, there's a lot of hope out there. It's just finding it. And sometimes when there's everything going on in your life, you can't see what's right in front of you because of your PTSD.
Yeah, I just reminded that we put a considerable amount of effort into working with Australia 21 to produce a document on dealing with first responder issues that had 39 recommendations for change. And rather disappointingly, I continued to find no one had ever read it. And governments were paying accounting firms to open the book on research when it had already been done. And reflecting on your time in the Northern Territory, of course, one of the terrific proponents of that work was Mick Palmer, who'd done his early time up in the Northern Territory and came down to Canberra to be with the Federal Police. But you know, these are the problems we have to deal with, that a lot of this work has been done. It just hasn't surfaced to the light of day with a lot of people. And I'm wondering now, when we think about partners and kids and family counselling, if you like, whether we need separate support mechanisms for them, because there's always a trickle of inquiries coming through saying, you know, who can I go and talk to because my partner has a problem, or, yeah, you know, a friend has a problem. And of course, we've always been pretty upfront saying, look, the first place to go to is a trusted GP to start the process of getting into the system. But we know the system's not that fantastic because of the wait times and things, and so on and so forth. But, you know, that emphasis on evidence-based research and new models of care and therapy has got to be there. So these are some of the things that we have to deal with, and it's some of the work we need to do to illuminate that inside the community. So when people talk to each other, they should say, have you done this? Have you thought about that? And so on and so forth.
Yeah, exactly. And I was just going to say, like, even with, as I say, obviously my background with first responders, and just having the ability to speak to someone about what's going on in your head, and knowing that you're trusted and there's not going to be any repercussions of, you know, career-ending information, just building that safe place, just knowing that knowledge is going to stay with them and getting the help that you need. So I find that'd be very important, obviously, having a different sector for, you know, families, somewhere for them to go, gather their information, and know that they can have a safe place as well to speak about what's going on in their family. Because obviously there's still a lot of stigma behind PTSD, and the self-awareness of actually what's going on is still not fully understood by many people. And just getting that information out there, I find it would be very helpful to a lot of people.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm thinking about people in the workplace now and bosses who have got employees or people working in their groups. You know, I guess the leaders need to have some education about what are the signs of someone struggling with PTSD. I mean, it might just be days off work, or it might be, you know, losing your cool over something that didn't seem that important at the time. I guess, is that something we should do? I mean, what about mental health first aid and all those other kinds of organisations?
Well, mental health first aid, no, they're in their lane. That's what they do. When it comes to PTSD, things are just a little bit different. And as you said, with leadership, having an empathy would be beneficial to a lot of leaders to understand what's going on with their personnel and just understanding feelings. I think we tend to forget about people's feelings these days, and we're very robotic in what we do. You know, you can be empathetic, but if you don't understand what someone's going through and having that mindset, I think you're missing a critical point in someone's life. They could potentially be showing you something, and if you don't see what's actually happening to them, how they feel, or ask them how they feel, you know, it's devastating for someone. And just getting that trust back and respect is very important.
Yeah, I think that's right. Looking on the Q&A, there are a whole bunch of suggestions coming through about things that we might consider. And I recognise some of the names there, of course. But, you know, there's an important one here about a membership base for people to join. And you promoted that as a possibility in the early years of your time as the chief executive. It'll be very interesting to see where this ends up, because I have to say that being members of an organisation like ours has been considered by the board on at least three occasions I can remember. And it always founders, because at the end of the day, when you ask yourself what would being a member offer you as a person, it was very hard to say there was much in it other than saying I'm a fearless person. I don't think there's anything wrong with being a fearless person, but I don't know that you need to be a member to be fearless, if you know what I mean. And it reflects back on the branding fearless that we obtained in 2014, because we like the ambiguity of the idea that we were asking people to be fearless about being introspective and realizing that they had a serious problem to deal with, but also fearless in going forward and getting things done about it. So I don't know whether you've thought about that in that way, Paul, but I'd be interested.
Yeah, in regards to the membership model, like obviously the benefits, just having like a one-stop information provider on governance and information, education of PTSD issues, advocacy, even funding opportunities for other members potentially looking at their organisations could be a benefit to them as well. And obviously being involved in the Fearless conversation would be fantastic, to obviously being members, a part of Fearless. And maybe potentially having a subscription model and promoting research, the current research is coming out to members. And so this is the latest research coming out in Australia or Germany or the US. And just having that access, I think, would be a lot of benefit to a lot of people.
Yeah. Oh, well, it's interesting. Evan Jones, whom I know well, is suggesting rather than membership, affiliation is probably a better word. And I think that's a merit. We might want to think about that one. It's kind of interesting. I think there's a lot to be thought about. It's all in the Q&As for us to think through. I want to thank people for putting the ideas in there, and we will take a record of the Q&A, and we will be thinking about that at our next board meeting and trawling through what we ought to do about it. Are there any other things that you'd like to talk about, Paul?
Obviously, the main goal is to obviously revamp the organisation, have a bit new direction towards the future. As I said, there's a lot of potential for Fearless to do amazing things in this space. Through partnership with other organisations, obviously not taken away from those organisations, but just being a part of the journey to help people, I think, is very important for Fearless. And as I said, there's amazing things that can be achieved down the track, I think.
All right. Well, I think being part of the journey is exactly what we're doing here. And welcome to a new direction for that journey, everybody. I think we've got plenty of stuff in the Q&A to think about. So I thank you all for putting your suggestions in there. And we'll do our best to answer those at the next board meeting and in the near future. Otherwise, Paul, welcome aboard. This is your first webinar. And of course, as the chief executive, you'll have the privilege of hosting a couple of webinars, I'm sure before the year's end. And finally, can I thank you all for your participation in this webinar, and especially those people that have put something into the Q&A. So thank you to all of you. That is very helpful. And welcome to 2024 and our future journey.
Thank you, Chris.